McGeeTV.
Welcome back to For the Love of Games. I'm Mike. My guest today is Paul Mock. He is a physician substitute and a comic book and video game enthusiast.
Indubitably.
Welcome to the show.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.
Okay, so what is the first video game you remember playing?
So many different memories. I have to figure out which one was the first one. It probably have to be when I was 4 years old, watching me finally breaking away. My mom tried to step away to do something, and I started playing the very original Super Mario Brothers on the NES.
Very cool.
I was also the first one of my siblings to beat the game, and I was the young one.
Awesome. So you had the talent right from the start.
Yes.
What's the first comic book you remember?
The first comic book I remember reading was, I was at the Choose gas station on Highway 80 on Tybee. Like right there at the corner where Highway 80 ends, there's that gas station right there. I asked my dad for a dollar. Normally I went and got an Icy, but instead I saw this Spider-Man comic. I'm like, this looks cool. And that's the first comic book I bought. I don't remember the art that well. I was just like, ooh, the Spider-Man cartoon, awesome. And not to mention the funny papers. I'd, like, the Sunday paper would come, can I have the funnies? And then,
what was your favorite comic of the funnies?
Oh, it was always going to be Peanuts. Peanuts all day, every day.
Yeah, I always like Garfield, but late, you know, as an adult, I look at Garfield, it's rather drab and not very funny. Dilbert, you know, is my favorite, I'd say, in the last few years, although I really enjoy the Boondocks as well, you know, Aaron McGruder's work.
Satire is always a good thing.
Indeed. So what's your happiest gaming memory?
My happiest gaming memory, besides beating Mario 1 before my siblings, was probably, what year was that? Seven. So that would have been 1993. I was sitting at a campground, and my brother had brought his SNES with him, and we're playing Super Street Fighter 2. And for the life of me, I could not get past an area level. And then I decided to play with M. Bison, and I learned the slide kick. And I just did that across the fucking screen.
Just spammed it.
Both ways.
Nice.
And like, nobody could beat me. He's like, I can't beat him. He's cheating. I was like, if I beat you, it ain't cheating. You just need to learn a new move. I beat like everybody that tried to come and play it. I beat the game that way. Like, that's like my favorite memory. It's like gold to me.
Awesome.
And I got to relive it recently. I went to a place where they had a retro gaming night, and they had SNES in the corner, and I'm looking through the games, and they had Super Street Fighter 2. I'm like, done. Bah! Dead again.
So what games are you playing now?
I don't have a lot of time to play games like I used to, but I've gotten really big into mobile games, because it's like every little downtime that I have at work, or every time that I'm like just sitting and chilling, I'm able to pull out my phone and play a quick game. I've been playing Float Free. It's a puzzle game. You have to try to connect the dots without them overlapping. I beat all like 2,000 plus levels besides the daily puzzles on the original version, and I've already moved over to the Bridges version, which I'm almost done with that as well. Another mobile game that I play is Dragon Ball Z Dokkan Battle. It's a GIF-style turn-based bubble pop thing based off of the Dragon Ball Z characters. You can level them up, and there's a little bit of a story to it, but it annoys everybody. So most of the time, everybody just goes the option, do you want the story on? No.
I played some mobile games myself. I really enjoyed a game called Hovercraft. It was a hovercraft game where you were driving down the road, and it was like Minecraft style. I thought it was really kind of just a fun little thing to do for, you know, a couple minutes here or there. I also played Sonic Dash 2. Those I really like. I really like, for me, like Endless Runners for some reason are kind of what I gravitate to on mobile. Although those puzzle games, they're like some of the most popular games out there.
So the hidden adventure games and stuff like that. I like some of those endless running games, but I feel like it gets monotonous sometimes, where it's sort of like, Same thing.
Well, I feel like you have to be in the mood for it.
Yeah.
You know, if you're in the mood for something kind of fairly mindless, you know, just sitting there, you know, swiping left and right to move your character and dodge.
But you can do that on Tinder.
Oh, Tinder. I didn't enjoy Tinder. That wasn't my favorite dating site there.
That's not dating. That's a game.
That's a game. That's what my problem was. I didn't understand what it was for.
It's a game.
I saw an episode of Family Guy where they had Quagmire on Tinder. And it was funny because he didn't understand it at all either. It was like Peter was the one explaining it to him. He's like sending a message on there, really elaborate, wordy message to a girl. And then like Peter's like, no, eggplant, emoji, volcano, emoji, and that's it.
And that's all you need. That's what Quagmire is.
Yeah, exactly. So. Well, he turned into like a golem-like monster that was obsessed with it towards the end of the show. It like completely wrecked his life.
Well, it took like 4 seasons for Quagmire to find out about the internet anyway, so.
Yeah. True. So, what comics are you reading now?
Oh, well, I actually brought one because I went to Planet Fun over this past weekend.
Over on Broughton Street in Savannah, Georgia.
And I'm a huge DC fan, and I'm a Batman fan. I'm also a giant fan of Aquaman, mainly because he's a blonde-haired dude who lives in the ocean with green eyes, and for some reason I identify with that. But right now I picked this up. It's Batman the Dark Knight. I'm a huge fan of Etrigan. I like a whole bunch of these obscure people that sometimes someone might not know about or doesn't have a no
some of the
too
less
about.
Mainstream characters.
So like, but not necessarily off-label, because I've never really read like a lot of Iron Horse comics or anything like that. Like, still major comics, but like the little side people that some people might forget. So like, Etrigan, you look at him, looks like he's a bad dude, because he's a fucking demon, to quote Jason Lee. But what Etrigan is that he, during the daytime, he has a duality. He's like normally a person. And then the person basically says a paragraph.
An incantation of some kind?
Yeah, he says, "Gone, gone, the former man. Arise, arise, the demon Etrigan." And then Etrigan comes out, and he speaks in prose and in poetry everything that he's going to do.
Oh, that's interesting.
Yeah.
So he's a verbose demon.
Yeah. And he's also badass. He has invulnerability, able to lift stuff, breathe fire. And he's actually a good guy. He's actually a member of the Dark Justice League.
Sort of anti-heroes.
Kind of, yeah. Sort of like the Spectre and the Question and stuff like that.
Yeah,
and Devilman.
I don't go off-label too much as well. I mean, I'm more of a Marvel fan than a DC fan per se. But I mean, I do have an appreciation for Batman. I really loved some of the comic books for that as well. As the animated series, I thought the animated series was really good.
A lot of the animated series are good. The original animated series, of course, is legend.
Indeed.
Kevin Conroy.
Yes.
And Mark Hamill.
Mark Hamill.
There's one thing, though, even though a lot of people say whenever I read Batman, Kevin Conroy's voice is in my head, when I read The Dark Knight and I saw this big, gritty, brr, dude, the dude's voice that was going through my head was Clint Eastwood.
Wow, that's interesting.
And I actually posted that onto
Reddit.
To their Batman subreddit, and I'm like, I know everybody in their head thinks Kevin Conroy when they read Batman, but does anybody else hear Clint Eastwood in their head when they read Dark Knight? And they're like, I ended up opening like this whole forum that people are like, that makes more sense than Kevin Conroy.
Well, I brought a comic from my collection. This is X-Men issue 3 right here. This came out in 1991. This is something that I would have had when I was 10. I really have enjoyed the X-Men series as a kid. There was a really awesome animated series for this as well. I watched that in the 90s. I thought it was really great. Oh yeah, that theme song, man. Classic theme song. You know, when I read Batman and I think of Batman's voice, I have to say Kevin Conroy comes to my mind, but also Michael Keaton. And even just a little hint of Christian Bale at this point. Yeah.
I'm Batman.
So, are you a console gamer or are you part of the PC Master Race?
Oh, I'm a console gamer all day, every day.
I hear you.
I tried to get in, and then by tried, I mean like I sat at a keyboard and tried to press buttons and see what would happen. I'm like, nope.
Didn't do it for you.
No. I'm like... And then you were having a conversation the other day where you were talking about Overwatch and how you can't even get in anymore because everybody's all clicky and like they're already on their mission. You can't join our mission because I'm like, that's not what a game is about. You shouldn't be able to like only be able to play it if other people are playing with you. The whole point of a game is you get to pick it up and play.
Yeah, with some of these online games, and especially stuff that's team-based, they want to try to balance the team in such a way that they're going to win. And I think that that desire kind of keeps out people that are new players that aren't as familiar, and they kind of want to test the waters and try out new characters. You know, I talked to an Overwatch player, and they were telling me that it's kind of a phase. That in the beginning, you're just kind of testing things out, and eventually you get to the point that you become one of those players that's focused on trying to build the right team to win, basically. But I get where you're coming from. I mean, for me, the point of playing a game is I want to have fun. And if I'm not having fun, then, you know, why am I wasting my money? Why am I wasting my time?
Exactly.
So, in your opinion, what is the best game controller of all time?
I'd watched your interview with Bruce Carr.
Okay.
Pretty good interview.
Oh, thank you.
With the No Ordinary Balloon Man. And he had mentioned the PCS2 controller.
And the PlayStation 2 controller?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And I was thinking about it, I was like, yeah, at the same time I was trying to think through my head, I'm like, my main memories is holding that original NES controller, because I had an NES for so long.
The square controller, right?
Yeah. And it's just because it's...
Well, the rectangular one.
Yeah, and I think that's just more because of, like, memories. Because I played NES after the 64 was out. I still didn't have an SNES. I had an NES from like 1986 when I was born until probably 1998 is when I got a PS1. Until then, I had an NES in my...
Well, that's quite the jump from console. So you kind of, yeah. You know, we mentioned you played Super Street Fighter 2 back in the day on SNES.
And that was my brother. He didn't really like live with me that often, so I didn't get to play it that often.
So you didn't have your own console of that. So you, in a lot of ways, you kind of missed a lot of that 16-bit generation. You went straight from 8-bit to 32-bit.
Mm-hmm.
It was kind of like that for me with the internet. With the internet, my dad tried out dial-up around the time that it was first available in our area. And then he had a bad experience with AOL. They promised him like 100 hours, like, you know, little discs they used to give out to everybody. And he didn't hit for free, right. And they tried to charge him some extra money before he had reached the end of that number of hours. And the experience was so bad for him that he kind of swore the thing off. And it wasn't until online gaming, like Delta Force was what he really enjoyed playing, that he got, Ethernet. You know, he got cable modem. Actually, I think we started with DSL. We had DSL, and then later on we got cable modem. So, you know, we went from Windows 95, really didn't have Windows 98, and then went to XP, you know, 58K all the way to DSL with no internet in between, you know, other than that brief experience. Yeah, completely life-changing.
Because I had similar, but I didn't have internet until I was already like in high school in my house.
Well, you know, one of the things for me is I didn't have a cell phone until much later. Like, I was walking around, everybody had their little flip phones, and I didn't have one. I didn't get a cell phone until, I had like a Nokia track phone, like a pay-as-you-go phone, and I used it strictly for calls and playing Snake on it, you know.
Me too.
Yeah. So, you know, it really wasn't until like 2006 that I really got a flip phone, and everybody's like, oh, well, welcome to the current age.
And I bought that flip phone from you.
You did.
And then shortly after that, I got the, what was it, the 2008 Sidekick.
Yep, I remember that.
Came out, and it had Mega Man on it, Mega Man 2, I think. And that's when I was like, a phone can do this.
Have you heard about the recent port they had for iPhone? I don't know if it was for Android or not. It might be. But they had a Capcom put out a Mega Man port of Mega Man 2 for mobile, and it's awful. Like, it runs poorly. It's like very poorly optimized. Like, what ran on your Sidekick probably ran better.
I think it probably did. Because I actually beat that game. And there's not very many video games that I've actually beaten. So that's part of like my great memories, is like being able to beat a video game because I was able to dedicate time to it.
Well, one of the things that really kind of struck me is that with these mobile games, it's all data. You're not getting cartridges, you know, it's digital media. And it's kind of like once those are gone, they're gone. You know, I'm concerned about that from a preservation aspect. I don't know if you're aware, but there's a pretty big preservation movement right now to preserve these games, keep this history alive so that people, later generations, can explore it. So a concern of mine is, is these early cell phone games, you know, are there files available for them? I've seen a few on the internet, but you really got to do a lot of digging. I remember I had a flip phone that had a Final Fantasy VII game on it that was a tie-in for Final Fantasy Dirge of Cerberus. And I love that game. I thought that game was great. I mean, if you were to look at it now, it's laughable with what we have on phones. But, you know, at the time, I have an appreciation for that because I remember when it was impressive to see a 3D model moving around on a phone.
Yeah, I had something similar to that. I had a Sony Ericsson flip phone that was, I mainly got it because it's like, it plays MP3s. I'm like, I finally have an MP3 player because I don't make enough money to own an iPod.
Right.
So I had it, and then it had like this little bear hunting bee game where like the bear had a gun and I was trying to shoot the bees to get the honey. And like, it was a platformer, but it was like, it was like three-dimensional platformer. Like you were actually like looking forward at the platform going up and down like this.
Oh, wow.
And I'm like, I'm doing this on a phone. Between that and the 08 Psychic, I'm like, I can do this on a phone. And it was probably to the point to where I was like, I still like console games. I don't have any newer consoles. I'm like stuck with the 360.
Yeah, well, I mean, you're not too far beyond that, the generation. You know, we were talking about Bruce. Bruce is a friend of ours. You know, he's still playing a Wii. You know, he's two generations behind. You're only one generation behind. So,
yeah.
You know, you just get yourself that Xbox One, you know, you'll be
fine. But that's partially because Nintendo puts out a new console every year as opposed to every decade.
It's not quite every year, but yeah, I get where you're coming from. So, if you could make your own game, what would it be?
That's a tough question. I was actually thinking about that earlier. And what it'd probably be is that I'm liking some of these comic book games that we're coming out with, like Lego Batman game, that was kind of fun, and then you have like Arkham City, Arkham Knight, and all that stuff. But one thing that I like is that a lot of people focus so hard on Batman, they don't realize that there's like a huge universe. And like they have the X-Men League of Legends game where like you got to play as all these different characters trying to fight the Sentinels. And what I was thinking was sort of like a story arc type game, like an RPG type game, and you unlock other characters and like you get to like unlock the entire DC universe, and each one has their own little role play arc.
Yeah, I might be wrong, but I can't really think of any kind of comic book based role playing game that you had like a party. I mean, I remember playing City of Heroes on PC. I don't know if you're familiar with that at all. Well, that was kind of interesting. You had like a small group of heroes and you would go on missions, but they weren't licensed heroes.
Yeah.
So I think if you had like a licensed RPG of DC Comics or Marvel Comics, or you know, maybe both, you know, that's a lot of opportunity there. I think that would be very interesting.
Because it would be great because like, I love fighting games too. Mm-hmm. Like I said, Super Street Fighter, Injustice is probably the main reason I was so glad to have a 360 because Injustice came out and I'm like, rocked my world.
Yeah.
I got to beat up Superman as Batman just to prove that Batman is better than Superman.
Agreed.
Every day, air day. All right. But part of it is like when you get to be in these games and like you see all these different characters, like you have a character like Booster Gold and everybody's like, who the hell is Booster Gold? He's a dude from the future. He's an egotistical bastard who has a time-traveling little dude that follows him around. And he reads newspapers like, oh, this is about to happen then? And time travels to the past to hijack somebody else's experience. And then the Justice League adopts him. So why not have a game where like you get to play like different little stories of all these different characters? You play as a character, then you get to unlock a new one.
Well, I think that's kind of interesting. I mean, I think it would keep it fresh. I mean, particularly if the characters had like different abilities, you know. Maybe switch up the play style a little bit.
Yeah, and then one game could last for as big as a universe is, and you just keep putting out downloadable content, which is what a lot of these games are going for now. Download some stuff.
I could almost say you could kind of do that for mobile.
Yeah.
That would be kind of interesting. So, what do you perceive to be the biggest problem in the game industry right now, developer side?
Developer side is making sure that you know how to capture the right audience. I feel like sometimes some people focus too hard on this one particular thing or that particular thing when, again, like you were saying with Bruce, like things are, you're able to bring so many people together with something. And I think some of the newer people that are developing games, they're not realizing that they're a part of something that's almost a half a century old now.
Yeah.
Like games, pinball machines, like starting back then was like the 60s. So video gaming, moving over to like these type of games, it's a it's a half a century old, you have all this history, and you're not looking at it to try to bring it back, because you're trying to bring back retro gaming, but you're just redoing what's already been done. Why not look at it and then make something new? Don't sort of like what movies are doing.
Okay,
now.
So yeah, I get what you're saying. I mean, you know, why remake something that's already been made? You know, I think that the retro audience kind of gravitates toward things that are very similar to what's come out before.
Nostalgia.
Nostalgia. I mean, you can particularly see that on Kickstarter, where you have a lot of people that formerly were with large studios, and they're releasing games that are very similar to the games they put out before, because the companies that own the intellectual property are no longer making sequels to those games. But I feel like there's room for innovation in that, though. I think that you could make something in the style of an older game if you add something new to it.
And that's what I'm saying, but don't remake the same thing. That's sort of what's making some people angry with Disney, is like, we don't need a live action Beauty and the Beast. I'm gonna see it anyway because it's Emma Watson, but we don't need a live action version of everything that was a cartoon once upon a time. It's not required. It was good where it was. Now, if you look at this, if you look at the princess movie and you're like, I like Beauty and the Beast, I like this idea of a person being cursed for the way that they treated somebody, and you create something similar to like a little kid story I was trying to write called The Porcine Pudge Monster, where this dude thinks that all of his subjects are bowing to him because he's too pretty to look at. And then this person's just like, you think we bow to you because you're pretty? We bow to you because we have to. And then, you're nothing but a porcine pudge monster to me. And he's like, whatever, what does that mean? You're a porcine pudge monster to me. And then he wakes up in the morning looking like the pig man from Captain Planet. And he's like, I'm not pretty anymore.
In your opinion, what's a major issue in the gaming community now?
A major issue in the gaming community is that people outside of it, and some of them inside of it, see gaming as a waste of time, as a time waster and a luxury. So you only play a game because there's nothing else wrong with you. You've hit pinnacle Maslow. You've done all of your hierarchies and you get to think about your further self, and instead of doing that, you decide to pick up a game and kill a brain cell. But for most people, similar to comic books, it's an escape. It's something that allows you to get away from what might be ailing you, whether it be suffering of a loved one, suffering in your own personal life. A good example of this is that when I was going through some personal stuff, whether it be that I broke my back or I lost my job and some other things that was going on with me and me trying to accept me for who I am, I picked up a controller because Mike said, hey, you might like Assassin's Creed. And lo and behold, I loved Assassin's Creed to the point that I was playing it 8 to 10 hours a day without realizing it. Because Mike would...
It was an outlet for you, in other words. It's like some of the guys I work with, they say that pressure busts pipes.
It does.
Yeah, so basically, you just let off a little bit of steam, you know. And I think that's healthy. I think that's therapeutic.
And people that know me knows that I need to let off steam, because if I don't, when I blow, it's not pretty.
Well, it's a much better way to do it than something that would be unacceptable.
Yeah.
I mean, I'd sooner, you know, sit down and play a video game than I would yell at somebody or break something, you know.
Yeah, or jump out of a window.
Aside from your day job, do you have any interests or hobbies related to entertainment or video games?
So one thing I like to do is actually collect trade paperbacks. Like, a lot of people are big into, like, collecting, like, the originals, like, to me, that's not the joy of a comic book to me. The joy for a comic book to me is the pretty pictures, the artwork, and being able to like see a story. Even though I picked up this individual issue because I wanted Edrigon, I like to wait till a series is completed. I can pick up a trade paperback, see the whole story, see all the art, and see where it goes.
Well, I think it's kind of interesting to look back at like how the art styles evolved. I have an appreciation for some of the earlier work of, like, say, Jack Kirby.
Mm-hmm.
At the same time, you know, I'm amazed by some of the work that I see coming out now, some of the technology that we have available in terms of creating some of this artwork is a lot more advanced than what we've had in the past.
Really, like, even these are, what, like, I think this is 09, like, these two are, like, 15 years apart. and you can see how.
Yeah, I mean, a 1991 comic book.
It's right, like here. A 2009, 2010, something like that.
So like the shading is like very different, but I have an appreciation for both sets of style. And one of the things that I thought was kind of interesting is you were telling me that they were doing like remakes of some of the older comics in this newer style.
Yeah, so like they brought back like 90s X-Men. Like I think that's actually what they're calling the series is 90s X-Men.
Oh, okay.
So it's like Wolverine in the classic animated series.
Like the blue and the
yellow.
The
chink.
Yeah.
Like all of that. They brought that back into a comic, but being able to use some of these more modern things so the lines are a little bit smoother. And stuff like that.
I think it's kind of interesting from the aspect that you're kind of reaching a new generation that way. I don't feel like it necessarily replaces the older work. I just think that it's just a way that you can attract an
audience.
It's
all new story. It's not even the same
story. Oh, it's not even the same story. No. Okay, that's cool.
It's all new stories.
So, do you have any projects in the works right now?
So, yeah, actually, I've been working on with a friend of mine, Ryan. She's going to be Catwoman, and her boyfriend, Pete, is going to be Batman. And they really wanted me to join them in cosplay. I've done Aquaman cosplay before. You saw the weak version that I had last year at Dragon Con, and then at Halloween the year before that, I came to work in a morph suit and briefs, and that was just about it. But they want me to be Etrigan the Demon, because they said, if we want you to do this, you have to be somebody who's bigger than Batman.
Because your friend's kind of on the
smaller side.
Smaller side.
He's like 5'8", 5'9", skinny dude. Like Christian Bale, but like half a foot shorter. So, like, I couldn't sit there and go, yeah, he's going to be that, but I don't want to be Bane because Bane's overdone. I want to do someone different. So the first thing that went through my head was Etrigan. And he was like, you know about Etrigan? I'm like, yeah. He's like, I knew I liked you. And he was like, that's perfect. So that's what I'll be working on.
Yeah, when we went to Dragon Con last year, that was the first time that I ever did any kind of cosplay in a public kind of way. Yeah, I've done a little bit of costume work here or there, but nothing really like that. And I have to say, mine was pretty weak. I did Handsome Jack, and I had, the 10th Doctor. But I didn't really have a lot put into it. I mean, I purchased my clothes. I didn't have something pre-made.
Yeah, the stuff for Etrigan, actually, my friend Ryan, she actually has a degree in theater and film as well. And she's actually going to be hand-making the costumes.
Oh, wow.
She's one thing that I might be buying that make her life a little bit simpler is a red singlet. That'll make it a little bit easier.
Are you planning on doing any kind of like makeup for this?
Yeah, actually, she's already told me the exact color that she needs. In the base to make it, I'm actually going to be yellow with a bald cap.
Like, it looks like this guy's got like fins and horns and
all
stuff.
All that shit's going down.
Oh, wow. Okay. Yeah. So is that like
this is like full costuming prosthesis.
I'm trying to remember, like, there's some kind of material they use to make that stuff.
It's foam rubber latex.
Yeah, that's what it was. That's
yeah,
it.
Yeah, she's going to be making that. Luckily, I'm not allergic to latex.
Yes. My fiance, she is actually.
Oh, poor lady.
Indeed. But
nitrile.
I've seen, nitrile. That's right. I've seen, in the local costume store that we have here, Acme Costumes over in Pooler, they sell some of those materials to do that professional style makeup.
And she's good at it. She actually released a short film that her actual boyfriend actually has a degree from Pemberton, I think it is, in New York, in directing. And he directed a short film, and the first film that he made and submitted, he already got put into a short film comedy contest. He didn't win, but it was very funny, and her boyfriend is, like, very attractive, like, very, very cute human being, and she made him look ugly, like, put, like, deep purple circles under his eyes, put pimples on his face. You would have thought that's what he actually looked like. They zoomed the camera, like, at 2 inches from his face, and you thought they were real.
See? We've definitely got to get some photos of that once you get that done.
Yeah,
we'll put that on the website.
Oh, that's going to happen.
Maybe some links to her work as well.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah. So you got another project coming in the works in May, right?
Yeah, I got this little thing called a wedding happening.
That's right.
It's going to involve Batman, Chuck Taylors, and a kilt. There's also going to be like mason jars and flowers, and then there's also going to be hooker dresses for bridesmaids. It's going to be trashy and classy.
There you go.
Which is me all day or day.
That's going to be the event. And then you're a groomsman in my wedding.
I am. A lot of work's gone into it, but I feel like none of the work's really finished. But at this moment anyway, because our other friend Bruce is getting married in like 9 months, and they're talking about stuff that I haven't even done yet, and my wedding's in less than two. Like cake testings and food tastings, and I'm like, I haven't done any of that yet.
Oh, you gotta have food, man. You gotta have a caterer, you gotta have
booze. I have all of that lined up, and I already have booze bought.
Why are you worrying about tasting then?
Because I haven't tasted their food. So I want to taste the food.
How'd you pick them?
There's this wonderful app and website called Thumbtack. You put in, you ask what you're looking for, you put in a budget, and these people send you quotes. And like I have like five quotes out there. There's two guys that I like. I'm going to taste their food, whichever one I like best, caters my wedding.
Oh, okay, that's cool.
It does a lot of the work for you. Like you can do the same thing for your officiant. Put in Thumbtack, wedding officiant, it's for this long. They send you a quote.
Gotcha.
I also got the same thing from a wedding DJ. That's how I got my DJ. And also have one sitting out there for something else. But just about any type of job you're looking for, you put it on Thumbtack. And the vendors come to you instead of you going to the vendor.
Well, if you and Sean need any kind of help with the planning, you know, just let me know. I have some ideas. Yeah, Audra. You can talk to Audra, too. You know, she's on Wedding Wire. She's looked up a lot of different ceremonies and different things you can do for decorations. So.
Well, actually, our friend Sandra that lives here, she's actually a wedding planner and event planner herself, and she's actually doing all of that for hours, and part of the wedding gift was like, I'll charge you just this little bit of money, and that whatever's over, I'll take care of the rest.
That's awesome.
So I got that going.
That's a nice gift.
It is, and we've already ordered, we already have like stuff like the tents and, well, not a tent, but tables and chairs like that. Like, the stuff that it takes to get the stuff done is done. It's just, we haven't done anything yet.
You got anything else you want to say to our viewers?
Stay awesome.
All right.
There was a time where that was my mantra. Like, everything was awesome. And not like as in, like, Lego movie. Part of Lego movie. I have, like, multiple t-shirts to say, it's not my fault. I'm awesome.
That's true. And you are awesome.
So, stay awesome.
Thanks for being on For the Love of Games. Thanks for being on McGeeTV. Really appreciate it.
I appreciate it. I'm a big fan. I'm glad I got to be a part of the experience.
Thanks.